Having made his debut in Borderlands 2's second DLC, Mr. Torg's Campaign of Carnage, Mr. Torg hails from the planet of Hephaestus. His full name is actually Mr. Torg High Five Flexington. His middle name, High Five, was actually his grandfather's name. It was a Flexington family tradition to use either your grandfather or grandmother's first name as the newer generation's middle name. Also, the Flexingtons refer to each other using their middle names. Unfortunately for Mr. Torg, both of his parents died when he was a child. They were tragically killed in an explosion in an iridium mine. Such an event affected him to the point of inspiration. Instead of letting the circumstance of his parents' death haunt him, he vowed to master the power of explosions. With his immediate family dead, Torg was raised by his grandmother. As you can see, the Flexington physique runs in the family. This was prevalent in Torg himself even when he was a child. He had facial hair and pectoral muscles at quite a young age. This caused him to be the target of bullying just for the sole fact that he looked different to everyone else. And because of this, he was actually very shy, especially when it came to girls. Torg's first prototype involved him strapping a stick of dynamite to the end of a Jacobs rifle. This was incredibly ineffective, but it served as a great starting point in his career. His drive to create guns that could explode without killing its user grew even more. Dozens of other tests and prototypes would get created until he eventually succeeded in creating a functional weapon. Various others would obviously follow suit. He founded the Torg Corporation, a weapons manufacturer akin to the likes of Dahl, Hyperion, Atlas, and so on. Being a public company, it needed a board of directors. The company acquired some, and Mr. Torg quickly ended up selling not only his designs, but entire company as well to them. All for the price of $12 and a high five. The board chose to keep him close, however. They began using him solely for PR reasons and to serve as the face of the company. This was something that Torg was initially all for. He always wanted to be famous and in the spotlight, and now he had it. He spent his initial time reaching out to any and all celebrities he could to get them to pose with his weapons. And while he was shy in high school and wasn't that interested in girls, after his newfound fame, he began coming home with models under each arm, living the lifestyle of your typical playboy. While this lifestyle sounds glamorous and pleasant, it all came at the cost of his passion. He stopped making weapons. Explosions hardly seemed to impact his life whatsoever. He became a changed man. He describes this era of his life as his darkest time.
I remember when Mr. Torg first sold his weapons tech to that board of directors, he was pretty egocentric for a while, taking pictures of himself and posting them to the EchoNet all the time, trying to hobnob with every celebrity that used his weapons. He came back home one day with a supermodel under each arm, and I said, "Mr. Torg, what are you doing? You've lost sight of who you are. It's been weeks since you actually created a new gun," I said. And it was true. He'd been more obsessed with being well-known for doing something great than with actually doing something great.
It was a dark point in my life.
Fortunately, he eventually got back on track and began creating weapons once more. His first gun that he created back was the Kerblaster. Time would pass and Torg's reputation and status continued to grow. He became well acquainted with many of Pandora's residents and they with him. He does make a most ever of brief appearances in the events of the pre-sequel in the form of side missions. He doesn't have any grand impact on the story, but he does at one point make you destroy a laser weapon, as he in particular has a disdain for them as they've hurt the sales of Torg weapons. So he has you explode one of theirs. His next major role took place in the town of Overlook back on Pandora. Mr. Blake of Hyperion was hosting a Vault Hunter competition and Torg had paid to watch it. It was meant to be a battle between Vault Hunters, where obviously the better one comes out on top and advances to face the next best competitor. Torg initially found the competition boring. However, it was thanks to Claptrap, who was placed in charge of fireworks, that it sparked Torg's imagination. Instead of using fireworks, Claptrap thought explosives would look much better, not foreseeing how dangerous that might be. Because of this, he accidentally blew up the arena, killing all of the competitors inside. Needless to say, Torg thought this was awesome and became inspired to do something similar on his own. In conjunction with this, he wound up discovering a vault on Pandora that could only be opened by a champion feeding it the blood of the ultimate coward. So before anyone else, particularly Tanis, had a chance to open this vault, Torg took the initiative and opened up his own tournament at its location and promptly named it the Badass Crater of Badassitude. Also, very importantly, this whole tournament was single-handedly funded by Mr. Torg himself without any money from the company. So, needless to say, it was something that he was very passionate about. And this is where the events of Mr. Torg's Campaign of Carnage take place. By now, the tournament has ranked many contestants, all in an effort to watch them kill each other and possibly open a vault. The Vault Hunters from Borderlands 2 enter the competition under the sponsor of Moxie. Slowly but surely, they climb up the ranks, taking down each one of the best competitors, until they inevitably beat the rank 1 Piston, who is the ultimate coward. By the end of it all, the vault is opened and the characters are rewarded with loot. But as for Torg, he faced a bit of a conundrum. The tournament he held was actually illegal, and so Moxie saw this as an opportunity to blackmail him and grow her business empire. She made a deal that if he gave her his arena, that she wouldn't tell the Torg stockholders about the whole thing. This was a proposition he couldn't refuse.
Calm down, Torg. You've got other things to worry about, like giving me your arena so I don't tell your stockholders about this little tournament.
How the f*** am I supposed to know that illegal off-world death matches are illegal?
Sugar, I think this is going to be the start of a beautiful relationship.
His next appearance would be within Tiny Tina's Assault on Dragon's Keep. In this, the Vault Hunters are all gathered to play a game of Bunkers and Badasses with Tina. Torg is brought along partway into the campaign as he wants to play as well. While I didn't bring it up anywhere else within his history because it didn't fit in too naturally, Torg is actually a big Bunkers and Badasses fan and a bit of a geek himself. When he becomes a part of the campaign, he has a total blast and begins sending players to blow stuff up as per usual from him. He and Lilith actually get into a little clash during this as well. Lilith sees Torg as a big macho man who's just hopping on board geek culture because it's currently cool, and so she ends up gatekeeping him out of some of the fun. But after he answers various trivia questions and proves to her that he himself is really a geek just like her, the two make amends. It might not seem like it, but this was actually an incredibly significant event in his life. While it wound up coming more naturally, so it was really hard to mention throughout his history, the Vault Hunters and various members of the Crimson Raiders are the only friends Torg feels like he really has. So, every moment he gets to spend with them, he treasures deeply. His value of the Vault Hunters would become incredibly relevant in the events of the Waddle Gobbler DLC. The Torg Corporation has rigged a challenge to anyone who can defeat an invincible turkey. No one could do it, as it was impossible, and so when the Vault Hunters take up the challenge, Torg doesn't want to see them die. So instead, he sacrifices everything he's gotten up until this point and turns his back on the Torg Corporation. While he's only been the face of it pretty much all of its lifespan, he chooses to make an enemy out of its board of directors and help the characters poison the turkey so they can kill it. As for Torg, he is no longer part of his own company. In the events of Borderlands 3, he would hold little to no significance whatsoever. Within the 7-year time span in between games, the only thing we know he's been up to was that he opened the Slaughter Shaft, which he narrates himself. This could be a small business he's opened up in the meantime that he's in full control of, or it could be a partnership with Moxie. He doesn't provide much dialogue in terms of story or where he's been. All we know is that the Slaughter Shaft is what he's been up to. Some other fun facts about Torg are that his censorship when he swears isn't actually done in post-production. Rather, it was a physical alteration made to his voice itself. So anytime he swears, it automatically censors him.
A lot of people been asking why my voice beeps all the f***ing time. The Torg shareholders wired my voice box with digital sensor, so I can't say stuff like s***, c*** or p*** your f***ing balls. That's like half my f***ing vocabulary. It's goddamn bullshit.
Also, in an interview with Tina, he says that he is 43.
Tonight our special guest is Mr. Torg. Mr. Torg, tell us a little bit about yourself.
Well, Tina, I'm 43. I'm the founder of the Torg Corporation.
Don't encourage her.
So that means during the events of Borderlands 3, he's about 50 years old. But for now, that does it for the history of Mr. Torg High Five Flexington, a character who's surprisingly not what he seems, but also exactly the type of person you'd expect. If there are any other characters you'd like to see me do the history of, then be sure to let me know in the comments below, and until next time, I'll see you in the next video.